Hi, this is Lindsay Petras.
I'm Aadam Sorma.
I'm Stephanie Bria.
Welcome to The Slaw.
Welcome to The Slaw.
The Slaw.
Very Local's podcast where we stay on top of all things Pittsburgh.
Each week, we highlight Pittsburgh places and Pittsburgh people.
We feature unique collaborations.
And even make some event recommendations.
The Slaw is all about the stories that make Pittsburgh, well, Pittsburgh.
Hey guys, what's up? This is Aadam. Welcome to another episode of The Slaw. Today our guest is Ben Wong. Ben Wong and his wife Kellie are behind a pair of concepts here in Pittsburgh, a pair of restaurant concepts, I'm sorry. They are behind Bahn Mi and Tea in Lawrenceville, and they're also behind Two Sisters over in East Liberty. A little bit about Ben. Ben is actually a native of South Philly. Ben is a native of South Philly. He attended college at Penn State briefly, transferred to Full Sail in Florida. After finishing up at Full Sail, he found himself moving to Pittsburgh in 2014. Ben is 32. He and his wife, Kellie, have a daughter, Sophia. And we're going to talk a little bit about the two restaurant concepts. So, Ben, say what's up to the people.
Hey, what's up? Yep, this is Ben Wong. Kellie and I, we opened Bahn Mi and Tea located in 4502 Butler Street, and also Two Sisters in 216 North Highland Avenue. So do your Google searches, Yelp, we're on there.
Heck yeah. Thank you, Ben. Yeah, so I think I would love to jump in and get started with the Bahn Mi concept. Okay. So for folks unfamiliar, what is a Bahn Mi sandwich and what can you get at Bahn Mi and Tea?
So a Bahn Mi and Tea, a Bahn Mi in Vietnamese means sandwich. That's as simply as it is, it just means sandwich. And when Kellie and I first moved here, I know Kellie, my wife, she always wanted to open a small cafe with her sister. And we thought there wasn't that many restaurants here that offered Bahn Mi's. So they basically gave it a shot. And we opened in November 2016.
So if you walk us through for the first time, if you're ordering Bahn Mi, mm-hmm. what can you expect inside the Bahn Mi sandwich?
So if for anyone that never had a Bahn Mi, I definitely highly recommend a traditional Bahn Mi. Traditional Bahn Mi is a cold-cut Bahn Mi that has three kinds of meat. Well, they're pork-related. One's called pork roll, pate, and head cheese. If you don't know what head cheese is, I actually do your Google searches, and because I'm not going to share that over the podcast. It's delicious. Every city you go to, and you're looking for like the top Bahn Mi places, they should have that traditional Bahn Mi. And so for Bahn Mi and Tea, we have what's called the Viet special, and that's our traditional Bahn Mi. Our bread comes from Breadworks. And so the three cuts of meat is pork roll, head cheese, pate, and ham.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's sweet. I know that also. I love when you order at Bahn Mi, they always give you the option of spicy or not spicy. Yeah. Walk us through when you get it spicy, you're adding on, is it basically like a jalapeno?
Well, yeah, you have to add the raw jalapenos to make it really spicy. but sriracha, that's, you know, you have to give it up to the sriracha god himself. And we have to put that. But I've noticed almost every other Vietnamese restaurant, the only spice there is just jalapenos. So we want to keep following that tradition.
That's sweet. And tell me a little bit about as far as what else is on the menu, because one thing that you guys do is bubble tea. Mm-hmm. And again, for folks listening, this is Ben Wong with Bahn Mi and Tea. So we talked about Bahn Mi, but what's on the tea menu?
So our tea menu, we have a mix of two kinds of bases. One's a creamy base bubble tea, and then one's a fruity base, right? So bubble tea, it's the, if you ever seen anyone that has those big cups with the black pearls down the bottom of the cup, those are tapioca starch. It's really popular, I believe, started in Taiwan. And we just do our own rendition of bubble tea. But what I like about our bubble tea is we partner with a Mighty Leaf brand. So I want to get the real tea out of the drink. Because I've had my fair share of bubble teas, and to me, it tastes like just sugar and water, and we lose the tea flavor. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what's up. I'm always a huge fan of the bubble tea, the tapioca balls. I didn't know it was tapioca and starch,
yep.
But it's very pronounced, like you see it.
Yep, yep. And if you're if you're traveling to other cities, the boba tea game is strong.
Yeah.
If you want boba, there's also jellies. There's popping boba. We just came back from Orlando. And there's this place that has cheese bubble tea.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Really? Did you try one?
I tried one, and I'm hooked.
You liked it. That's what's
I liked
up.
It. Wow. Yeah, yeah. It's actually, I think it's like cream cheese and whipped cream as a topping. And
okay.
Yeah, so.
That's rad. Let's pivot a bit, because I also want to spend some time talking about Two Sisters. So yep. Two Sisters is a pho concept East Liberty.
Yeah. So I think two of the biggest dishes in Vietnamese cuisine is the sandwich, which is the banh mi, and then of course pho. Pho is their noodle soup, either made in beef broth, chicken broth, and in our place we also have vegan friendly and also seafood broth. So at the Two Sisters location, we specialize in the actual noodle soup, versus at banh mi and tea, we're more focused on just the sandwich.
So let's say you've never been to Two Sisters in East Liberty. Mm-hmm. What's your advice as far as what to order, how to interact with the menu? Walk us through how you would guide someone.
So if you're at Two Sisters, if you've never had Vietnamese food, then you have to have pho, the beef noodle soup, because every Vietnamese restaurant will have their rendition of beef noodle soup. So I definitely highly recommend you try ours. So it's either noodle soup, dry noodles, which is vermicelli bowls, or also we also have rice dishes. Shaking beef, that's Kellie's uncle recipe. It's interesting. It's a filet mignon cut into pieces, and it's over on a wok with his like homemade sauce. It's like sweet, spicy. It's interesting. It's pretty good, and the platters are fulfilling.
Yeah. Do you know why they call it shaking beef?
Because, yes, I do. when he cuts up the filet mignon and he puts it in the wok, he's shaking his wrist. Oh. So over the fire. So yeah. Shaking beef. Yeah.
That's what's up.
Yeah. So we try to come up with like funny names. Like, for example, at Bahn Mi and Tea, if you want the chicken Bahn Mi, we call it the classy chick. You know?
Mm-hmm. I've seen that.
The beef Bahn Mi, it's cooked in sweet wine and onions, so we call it the drunken beef. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we try to have a play on words on
that's
on
sweet.
Yeah.
Going back to Two Sisters, I want to know, I know that this, again, it's like prime winter noodle soup. It's super hearty and fulfilling, yeah. And it just hits the spot. Do you guys have any seasonal changes to the menu or seasonal tweaks that folks can expect?
Yeah. I prefer to not have any changes to our standard menu for both places. What I do love, and I know my family loves, is when a customer does come in and they ask for something special that they had in Vietnam. Somehow, like my mother-in-law, my wife, their eyes just light up. And they'll try their best to make it. Like, for example, I had a customer that came in. This is at Bahn Mi and Tea. Someone wanted the egg iced coffee, where it's a Vietnamese iced coffee and you drop a raw egg.
Oh my gosh.
And it's actually really good.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And then my sister-in-law, her name is Twin. There was no customer. So of course, why not? So she went to the back and made it for the customer. And yeah, it was like.
And she dropped a raw egg into it.
Yeah, dropped the raw egg. Then she mixed it really, really well, where when you mix it really well, actually it gets cooked. Yeah, the raw egg. So, and the customer was just like, this is what I had in Vietnam. So like, yeah, so we did our thing.
That's amazing. Yeah. Wow, what a story. Jeez.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about bringing your family to Pittsburgh. This is a bit of a pivot, but I want to hear about what brought you guys here. I mean, beyond just the restaurant, just talking about family and how you guys moved across Pennsylvania from Philly to here.
Well, when I was in Philly, you can say I was at a dead-end job. My wife was sort of at a dead-end job, but we were content, right? But I wanted to test the waters, see what I can do to better myself in the career. So I reached out to a few staffing agencies because I know around that time there's many companies that had staffing agencies, and Pittsburgh was definitely one city. Atlanta was another opportunity, but I had a contract in Atlanta for only 4 months versus in Pittsburgh. It was for, I believe, 2 years. And it's also closer to family because everyone's in Philly and New Jersey. So we decided to give Pittsburgh a try, and Kellie always wanted to open the cafe here in Pittsburgh, and the rest is history. And Kellie moved. Her sister-in-law gave up her life to move here to Pittsburgh, and then mom and dad came, and here we are. If you go to Bahn Mi and Tea, you open that door, you're going to see Kellie, see Twin, and in the kitchen is literally just mom and dad.
Yeah, it is like peak family in peak there. Family. And occasionally you'll see Sophia, your daughter.
Occasionally you'll see Sophia. She'll wave at the customers. And we have a few staff there to help as well.
Yeah, that's awesome. I want to hear about what it's like to treat someone to Bahn Mi or pho for the first time. I feel like I live near your restaurant and I love it. But occasionally, especially on the weekends, Lawrenceville draws in a pretty massive crowd to like walk and shop and hang out and eat and just enjoy the neighborhood. Have you been a part of that moment when you see a customer try Bahn Mi for the first time?
Oh, yeah.
What's that like?
When you have customers that are not local to Lawrenceville, they'll park at, I've had customers that park at 40th Street and they'll walk their way up towards our shop. But then they've stopped over in other places, grab a bite to eat, shopped at Wild Card clothing. And then once they get to our spot, they're full. But then they'll stop in for a Vietnamese coffee for dessert. I've had customers that came in and came to our spot first. I would always suggest to try a Bahn Mi first. Because everything that you're eating, it's here, local, in Pittsburgh. The bread's coming from Breadworks. The meat's over at Ship District Meat. So everything's it's all made here locally. And I definitely recommend to customers, try a Bahn Mi first with the Vietnamese iced coffee.
Yeah, right on. Oh, I love that. Oh, gosh. I love the condensed milk. It gives it that extra.
Yep. And we use a Cafe Du Mont brand coffee because that's like one of the top coffee brand with chicory. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I noticed you guys have the cans out by the display. Yeah. Well, here's a question I'd love to hear. Tell us a little bit about the minority community. I mean, have you had a chance to meet other members of the Vietnamese or Burmese Chinese diaspora? Because I think here, like the Asian diaspora is sort of, you know, you see them in Oakland, you see them in Squirrel Hill. Have you had a chance to make friends or meet other Vietnamese families here?
Oh, yeah, we have. We definitely have. We have Nancy from Pennsylvania had hosted many events at Bahn Mi and Tea. When, you know, growing up in Philly and Jersey, I mean, when you talk about Asian community, it's like there's a Chinatown, there's a Viet town, there's a Korea town. So when we moved to Pittsburgh, we were like, oh man, we kind of took it for granted, you know? So now we have to find people to tell us, hey, where is a good Korean restaurant? Where is a good Chinese restaurant here in Pittsburgh? It's not as big as a city like Philly, New York, but it's a little humbling because it makes you want to try harder to find us, minority group. Yeah.
How did that happen? How did you come to a point where you thought, you know, Kellie and I, we love food and we love it enough that we're going to build a business on food?
I think our love of food, it's the whole process. To be honest, anyone, and I'm saying not just Asian, can make an Asian cuisine, right? We can go online, look at the recipe. We can watch YouTube videos on how to make pho. I think what makes, what sells is our intention and the vibe. Our clear intention on Bahn Mi and Tea is we love to cook. We want you to try our rendition of Bahn Mi's and pho. It's the fact that the people, the community took us in and we just stayed to our roots. I didn't do anything special, didn't go out of our way to make something. How do I say this? We can put sushi in our menu, but we're not Japanese. You know, my family's Vietnamese. So they want to stick to their roots and they're not going to bend over backwards for anyone to ask for. Because
right.
At first we did have a couple of customers that asked for, do we have pad thai? Do we have sushi? And we're like, no, we're a small Vietnamese restaurant. We make Vietnamese food.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I feel that here in Pittsburgh, there are some restaurants, I'm not going to name anybody, but you know, they have a rendition of a little bit of everything. And usually the quality is not there.
What excites you about the future of Pittsburgh?
What excites me about Pittsburgh is, I have to say, the tech companies coming in. They know something that maybe we don't, right? They're the ones that are building, you know, I've heard Facebook is here, you know, Google's here. So, and they're building these more buildings around the Strip District. So something's happening. So when something's happening like that, then you're going to have different kinds of people coming to Pittsburgh, which is going to create more of a bigger melting pot. You know, I personally think that there's a beauty behind not just seeing one point, because when you have multiple points and many points coming in, now you could actually choose what you like as a customer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's sweet. Yeah. It does open up more options. Like, you're totally right.
And I believe life should be about options. We should not have a single point of view.
What are some places that you like to go to unwind? Because I love asking people, like, if you and Kellie have a favorite spot that you like to go out to eat, that's not just Bahn Mi and Tea,
Two
Sisters.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Because, you know, you guys own them. But what are your spots to go to grab a drink or grab a bite that you guys are falling in love with here in Pittsburgh?
Yeah. So this is definitely one of the hobbies that my wife and I love to do. When we're in Pittsburgh, you know, depending on what we're in the mood for, we do have certain places that we'll go first and then we'll try another place. For example, where we're craving for barbecue, first thing that comes to mind is Gaucho.
Oh, man.
Oh my God.
I love Gaucho.
We've been there, even when Kellie was pregnant, we was there every Friday. She can only have red meat.
Yeah.
Nothing else. And I was fine with it. And out of all, I'm really going to say 20 times that I went, it's excellent.
Yeah.
Food is great. When it comes to other Asian cuisine, you definitely have to check out Yuzu Kitchen.
Oh, downtown?
In downtown.
That's what's up. Yeah.
I started by Kai Guo. What up, Kai?
Yeah, shout out to Kai.
Yeah, shout out to Kai. If you're a fan of ramen, then you go to him. He knows all the technicalities of ramen and the broth, and he's sourcing the highest level of ingredients, okay? Not to throw shade at Roger, who owns Key Ramen in Lawrenceville. That is still also good as well.
Totally.
Yeah. Roger's restaurants in Lawrenceville, Key Ramen, Unami, Key Pollo, those are all great as well. Yeah. Man, there's just so many restaurants. And I definitely like meat and potatoes. If I'm really craving for a steak, meat and potatoes and Hyde Park are the two, one of our favorites.
Yeah, that's what's up. I guess the final thing I wanted to ask you was a little bit about the future with the restaurants, because if you're ready to talk about any upcoming concepts. I mean, I know we had kind of flirted with like Oakland and talking about other neighborhoods, and this is entirely your call, but what can folks expect from you and Kellie in the future?
We are definitely looking to open more concepts. Of course, at the end of the day, we don't have enough capital. We have so many ideas that we want to expand on. It's just funny how Bahn Mi and Tea is a 13-seater cafe, so the scale was really small. Then, you know, our aunt always wanted to open a restaurant, so we worked with her, and now we have a full kitchen restaurant. So we have a small cafe and a full kitchen restaurant, and we're thinking of opening another concept, maybe more geared towards street food style. Remember I mentioned about cheese boba tea. The palate is just so, there's just so much out there. And we're working on different recipes, different things to put on the menu. What we also like to do is to put, let's say we want to try something out, we'll put it at Bahn Mi and Tea, we'll host a pop-up. And if it responds well, then we'll put that on the menu into our next venture.
That's awesome. Yeah. Ben, thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, thanks, Adam. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
We really appreciate you being on the Slaw. And for folks listening, that was Ben Wong. Ben Wong and his wife, Kellie, are the folks behind Two Sisters, pho, Vietnamese pho concept in East Liberty, and Bahn Mi and Tea, which is our beloved Bahn Mi concept in Lawrenceville. Cool, man. I think that's pretty much all we've got for today. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Adam. Thank you so much, man.
Yeah, totally.
Hi everyone, it's Stephanie, and my event pick for this week is something that happens every Wednesday night. It's Banjo Night at the Elks Lodge in the North Side, combined with Bluegrass Jam at the Park House right around the corner. So essentially, I'm telling you what you should do with your Wednesday night, next week, any week, all the weeks. I have a soft spot in my heart for Banjo Night. Essentially, I owe my relationship to Banjo Night. Banjo Night is a Northside institution. There's been documentaries made about it, like a ton of press. They've made a lot of best of lists. And every Wednesday since, I don't know, forever, the Pittsburgh Banjo Club has been opening up what is essentially their weekly rehearsal from 8 till 11 p.m. I would say that it's a little tight for a rehearsal. It doesn't seem like there's a lot of practice going on. Really, you're just getting a show. Attendance may vary, but the stage is always considered full of banjos. So they're just sitting in rows, right? There's a little bit of a backing band, some supporting musicians, but folks dance and sing along. There's cheap drinks, like I mentioned. The crowd ranges from 8 to 80 plus, really. Like I said, it's a classic Pittsburgh experience. You'll see people that you know. You'll see famous people. Sometimes you'll see the mayor, I'm sure. And then starting at 9 p.m., you can actually literally walk around the corner to the Park House for Bluegrass Jam, which is hosted by the Shelf Life String Band. The live music here goes until midnight, and there's free popcorn and more dancing, and they play traditional bluegrass jams and covers of popular songs. I will tell you that I have once, actually maybe twice, maybe even three times, heard the theme from Titanic. So it's an entire evening of collaborative music and cheap drinks every Wednesday in the North Side. And I realize I plug a lot of North Side events, but to quote the shirt of a dude I saw drinking in Verdetto's, there are only two sides of Pittsburgh, the outside and the North Side.
Collaborations. Hey guys, what's up? This is Aadam. I'm here and I want to come at you with a collab. It's a collaboration that we're pretty excited about for 2020. It's Rolling Pepperoni. Kat Schuler from West Virginia is behind that concept, and they have collaborated successfully with Honeycomb Credi. For folks unfamiliar, Honeycomb Credi provides crowd-financed lending to small to medium-sized businesses that basically rely on a business's pre-existing fans and community base to raise funds that get paid back with interest. So, fun fact, Rolling Pepperoni is making awesome Appalachian pepperoni rolls, and they will now have a full-service brick-and-mortar retail space in Upper Lawrenceville located at the base of the 62nd Street Bridge. Kat Schuler, who's a native of West Virginia, is trying to bridge the divide between urban and rural communities and is doing that with these delicious, amazing pepperoni rolls that she's making in that authentic WV style. So thanks to this awesome collab between Rolling Pepperoni and Honeycomb, we can now check out this awesome cafe that's going to be opening in 2020. So major shout out to Kat Schuler, to Rolling Pepperoni, and to the team at Honeycomb Credi for basically successfully launching this crowd financing campaign that's led to now a new space for us to enjoy.
If you know of any upcoming events you think we should know about, or if there's a very Pittsburgh collaboration you think we should highlight, call us at 412-368-6595 and leave us a message. And thanks so much for listening.
Make sure you subscribe,
rate, and review The Slaw on iTunes
or wherever you listen to podcasts.
If you like what you're hearing, follow us at Very Local PGH on your preferred social media channel.